need that real talk, well, J-Mad, he got ya. Right here doing God's work, bringing life after the collar. Hey, radio show, and he's doing it big. You just can't ignore. J-Mad, bringing you the word, just holler at your boy. Hey, life after the collar with J-Mad.
This is your boy, J-Mad. And I want to welcome you all tonight to Life After the Collar, where it's going to be all good and all gravy. You know that's my line right there, all good and all gravy. We're going to have a great conversation tonight. We're going to hit so many different topics tonight. And if you want me to hit up on anything, I need you to chime in on spreaker.com/show/LATC, Life After the Collar. And we're going to have a good conversation tonight. We're going to go different things. I know I really want to start off. Let's go this way. We're gonna dive into some good conversation. I think tonight I want to hold accountability. I want to use the word accountability tonight, not only for me as an individual, because I want to hold myself accountable as well. Not only as men, not only for women, but I want to hold us accountable as a nation. I think it's the best way to put it. But we're going to have a good conversation tonight. But let's listen to these couple of jams and let everybody get in and get settled in. Thank you so much for listening to J-Mad on Life After the Collar. Holla at your boy. I tell you what, it's going to be a real good night. Holla at your boy.
But now I know better. How does it feel?
Yeah, this is your boy J-Mad, and you are listening to Life After the Collar. Look, we're going to have a great conversation tonight. Tonight is all about what I am going to title accountability. We're going to talk about different areas of accountability. My mic is jacked up. My bad. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm all the way real. I don't even try to be professional sometimes. But we're going to have a great conversation tonight. I want to talk about accountability. And let me share what led me up to this conversation today. Oh, because it actually happened earlier today, and I was writing down notes and things like that. I was watching the French president. I don't know what's going on with this bromance with Trump and the president of France. I ain't even going to try to jack his name up. But they got some... Anyway, that's not my point. But it is some serious bromance stuff going on with them. Let me try to straighten my mic up. But we were, I was looking, because he spoke to Congress today. I'm going to use the word accused. I'm not really accused. It's a fact. I can watch news 24/7. I can watch news 24/7. 24/7, my face is connected to the news. CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, NDWX, Y, and Z. I'm just hooked up to the news. I love news. I don't really watch too much local news because that's always some always hating, you know, people always shooting people and all that other stuff. But I love news. But I also like the live coverage of different things. There go my daughter, my spiritual daughter, Renelle, Pastor Renelle, good to see you. She's up there in Canada. So the French president spoke to Congress today. Now, the accountability came into play. It wasn't when he was speaking. It was really the entrance of, like, the vice president, the speaker of the House, leader of Congress, all of this other stuff, the top people coming in. And when they're walking in, I'm not. This is going to be real talk. I was going to say I'm going to be real PC. I'm going to be real talk. When they were walking in, it's one thing that I noticed. And what I noticed was, it's an equally, unequally balanced of what's going on in Washington. And I would even suggest in complete politics. I saw so many old white guys that were in charge, that was a politician, that was our leaders. When I looked at Congress today, I did not see America in there. I did not see America at all in Congress today. It was mainly old white guys. But I do not blame them. This is real talk. I don't blame them. They kept writing their name on the ballot. They kept doing what they needed to do in order to get on the ballot to run for the next election. I blame African Americans. I blame all the minority groups. I blame even when it comes to women. So I'm not going to make this a race thing. This is not a race thing. I'm just saying that in the end, when I looked at Congress today, when I saw the French president coming in, when he spoke, you probably could throw 100 rocks out there and not hit one minority. You throw a handful of rocks out there, both hands, fistful of rocks, and not hit one minority in the group. And that's including women. That's including blacks, Hispanics, Asians, whatever the case may be. Our politicians does not in Washington, let's just keep it with Washington. It does not look like America. And if D.C. is supposed to be for the people, if they're supposed to be making laws and all of this stuff, Deanna, good to see you. Steve, good to see you. Steven, good to see you. If we're supposed to be doing this for, if the politicians are supposed to be speaking for us, they should be looking like us as well. Shout out to the minority politicians that are in office, and a majority of them are the older politicians, those that have been in office for a while. It's time for us to be held accountable. It's time for us to be held accountable for our actions. Even, and tonight's topic on life after the college is accountability. We're starting with politics. We're going to dive into parenthood. We're going to dive into being a man, woman, All of these other different areas, a Christian, all of this, we're going to dive into that. We're going to start with holding ourselves accountable, because this is where the subject came from. Ms. Gooden, good to see you. Gordon, good to see you. we have to, and I've been saying that I'm going to run for political office. I've been saying that for a while. I think it's time for me to put my money where my mouth is. Put my actions where my mouth is. Because I was embarrassed of how many old white men are in DC. So I'm not exclusive making this a race thing, because I think it should be young white guys there as well. To be president, you have to be 35 years to run for president. We need youth. We need vigor. We need change. Right now, D.C. is so bombarded with old ideas. They're so consumed with all kind of older things, older thoughts, older process. Many of them. I was watching. I even was watching when, the owner of Facebook was at his hearing thing. Because of what happened with the data breach. He had to explain to a lot of those older folks basically what internet is. Had to explain to them what social media was. What's the purpose of it? Majority of them had no clue. And we're behind time. So if you want to know why we suffer the way we do suffer, whether it was laws and all of these things and trying to advance, and why we are falling behind with a lot of countries, is because we're still stuck in the old age with the old mindsets in D.C. as our politicians and stuff. It's time for us to step up our game. I'm holding all of us, each and not only voting. We that's the big thing. Get out and vote. Get out and vote. Get out and vote. Forget all of that. Get out and run for office, a councilwoman, a councilman. For this, for these smaller things, get out and run for some of these offices. That's the hold. I'm holding all of us, women, men, black men, minorities. Get out and do something. Get together and say, "Hey, y'all, let's do this. Find a candidate that you can get out and push." Because right now we're behind. We're so far behind on this thing. Making rules and regulations and all of this other stuff. We're so far behind. And we have to catch up. We have to catch up on this thing. I'm sitting there looking, and I'm waiting. I was sitting there watching the people run in, walk in, and the people that was shaking hands. And the black congressman, his name is slipping my mind right now. The bald-headed guy from Georgia. When the people was walking down and they was walking in and they was shaking everybody's hand, this one politician reached right over him and ignored him. I'm glad to see what he did. He reached and grabbed her and made her shake his hand. Y'all, we got to make our politicians. We sitting here complaining about the laws and all of this other stuff. We need to make our politicians look like America. We need to make our police force look like America. You can't sit there and complain when we are sitting at home doing nothing. It's time to be held accountable. No, there's no such thing as the man anymore. I don't care how we put it. We can sit there and blame it on the man. No, that's BS. That's all BS. We blame it on laziness. We can blame it on not getting out and doing what we need to do. We can blame it on all talk and no action. That's what we can blame it on. Straight up accountability. We have to be accountable. We're starting right now with the political world. But we have to learn that we just can't run off at the mouth over politicians and what they're doing in D.C. and what 45 is up there doing. But you didn't even get out and vote. Two, you didn't get out because there were plenty of good candidates running for the presidency. But because we was not informed the way we needed to be informed, a lot of us voted for popularity. Who I know. In reality, now we was left up with two jacked up candidates. And you would vote for Twiddly D and Twiddly Dumb. And it didn't matter which way we was going. Tonight, y'all, on Life After the Collar with J-Map, we're talking accountability. We just talk about politicians. We're going to go another direction when we come back after this musical break. But it's going to be on and popping here on Life After the Collar with your boy, J-Map. Holla if you hear me.
Yeah.
You're listening to live to J-Man on Life After the Collar. Tonight we're talking about accountability. We have a lot of things that we want to talk about tonight concerning accountability. We was just talking about our responsibility and our holding us accountable for the political world. That why is it, you know, I was saying that I watched a lot of CNN, and I was watching the French president talk to Congress today, and on his way in, and they was leading up to the different politicians are coming in. Thank you so much, Michelle. I appreciate it. I got some good news afterwards as well, concerning the show and advancing the show out and different other things. But when he was walking in, and when like the vice president and the speaker of the house and Ryan was all them, those guys was walking in, it was noticeable the difference in the people that we have as our leaders in D.C. It could easily be said that 90 to 95% of the politicians, in D.C. is old white men. It's not their fault. They did whatever they needed to do to get their names on the ballot. So I was holding everybody else accountable. I was holding men, minority accountable. I was holding the young people accountable, and I was holding women accountable, because Congress, House, and every state, city, all of that stuff, it should look like America. It is what it is. It is what it, accountability. But I want to switch this thing now, and I'm going to start this way, because I was going to dive in into some serious topics. I want to hold Jason accountable. Oh, here we go. I want to hold Jason accountable. I want Jason to be a better man, a better father, and a better leader. I was even on the when we was talking about the political world, I've been running my mouth the whole time about, you know, getting more involved with politics and run, maybe possibly running for office, whether it's on a local level or national level or whatever. I got to stop running my mouth. Either I'm going to do it or I'm going to shut up. Either I'm going to be about it or I'm going to go sit my tail down somewhere. I was getting ready to put it another way, but you know, y'all, I got my Super Saiyan folks on here tonight. Either I'm gonna put my mouth where it is, behind my actions, or I'm gonna shut up. That goes along with being a man, period. I'm gonna start right there. Starting with me first, but I want to talk to men across the board. Men across the board. I'm holding us, capital U.S. I'm holding us responsible. A lot of things that's going wrong with our homes, with our children, in relationships, is simply this. Men, we are out of place. I'll say it again. Men, we are out of place. I want you all to get this. Men, I want you to listen to me real good. Men out of place leaves children, our children, misplaced. And the women in our lives misplaced. All because we're not where we're supposed to be. And we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. And it starts from being a father. Far too long. And this is not just black men. I want to get that misconception out of the way. They're dead, all kind of men out there. Deadbeat, all kind of men out there. It's not just the black men. But men, we have to learn to be better fathers. We have to train our young men, our sons, how to be gentlemen. How not to start chasing the skirts all the time. I understand that there's a different mindset when it comes to growing up. Yes, women grow up, they're playing with dolls, they picking out weddings, you know, they 5 years old, 10 years old, trying to marry Barbie and Ken together. They done got the ring, the color of the scheme for the wedding, and all this other stuff. So in their minds, they're mentally preparing for being in committed relationship. We're nowhere near that way. Women, I need, and here's one of the things that I need women to understand, and men, we have to do a better job at this. But women, I understand that when we as young men, little boys, it's only one thing we're taught: to conquer, and once you conquer, go on to the next thing. You let's go sports. You conquer little league sports, baseball, basketball, baseball, football. You're groomed to go, okay, that's nothing. You done did all of that. Let's see what you really made up now. We're getting ready to go in middle school. That thing that you just did over in Little League means absolutely nothing. You got a whole different thing you got to conquer again. Yeah, you made it through middle school. Now you're in the big boy leagues. You got to go. Look, you at the bottom of the totem pole. This is freshman year of high school. You got to earn your keep on this team here. You could have been all of that in high school. I mean, in middle school. You're in high school now. You got to earn your keep. And the rules kept changing. The rules kept changing. And it's the same way in real life when it comes to dealing with women. Because when we was with our mothers, within the absence of our fathers, let me say that again, in the presence of our mothers and they raising us, in the absence of our fathers, we got one set of rules. Because mothers love their sons and raise their daughters. Vice versa. Men love their daughters and raise their sons. So you get your mother saying, oh, you know, brush it off. Oh, you cry. She come and she grab you and she nurture you. And, you know, so you're supposed to cry because when you cry, mama is going to be there to save you. But now you're in high school and now the rules are totally different. And they're looking at you like, why you out here crying? It's big boy. This you're supposed to be a big boy. What's all this crying about? And now the world is teaching us not to cry. And in a lot of cases, it started seeping into the women are teaching the sons that it's not right for a man to cry. You're not supposed to cry. But let the man be fully grown and unjacked up on something, and he don't cry when he's apologizing to you. Now he's not being sincere because he ain't crying. But as fathers, we have to get back into play. And I'm not talking about blood fathers. I'm talking about men being fathers to the village. Men, we are letting our sons down. We are letting our daughters down. Because we are not in place. We're not in place. And or we're teaching them the wrong things. A lot of times we're just simply teaching them the wrong things. FYI, for example, you treat the child's mother any kind of way. You treat her any kind of way. What does that tell your son? That's what he's supposed to do. That's how you're supposed to treat women. What does that tell your daughter? This is what you're supposed to expect. This is how men are supposed to treat you. I'm treating your mother this way, so this is how you should expect a man to treat you this way. We have to get back in the game, man. All of us. I made some huge mistakes as a father. In one marriage that I was in, I had to pull my sons aside and apologize to them. And I told them, I dated in front of you all wrong. See, back in the day, when it came to my sons, my two older sons, if I dated in front of them. And they saw me, you know, because it was like this. If they said, no, Dad, that's not the one, I'll cut her loose. Well, the next time they came over, I had another woman over. I'm not the best looking guy in the world. I don't consider myself good looking at all. I'm an okay looking guy. I'm a small frame guy. I'm an all right looking guy. This beard is helping me a lot. It is. This salt and pepper beard is helping me a lot. But I don't consider myself a good guy. But on the other side, I've never had a problem with getting a woman. Look, I've never had an issue. Especially, anyway. But every time my sons would come over, they would see a different woman over. Especially if they was like, Dad, after one lady leave, and at the end of the weekend, they was like, nah, Dad, that ain't her. You don't need to be dating her. That's no. and I would cut her loose. But they saw me date so many different women, and that was wrong. That was so wrong. Thank God I don't have daughters. I'm holding myself accountable. That was man, father. Let me talk about us as husbands. Men as husbands. I'm not talking about in a relationship. Not talking about in a relationship. Because there's a conversation I need to have with the women and hold the women accountable in this area. But as a husband, let me tell you. Y'all, we got to step up our game in being a husband. I'm going to start right here. Never lose you when you get married. Never stop being you when you get married. Either be a better version of you, but the foundation of who you were and who she met. It's the one that they want. They want you to improve. See, here's the thing, guys. Let me help y'all out. This is something that I learned along the way. A woman dates a guy and marries a guy hoping that he's going to improve. He's going to get better. He's going to change. A man, when he marries a woman, he's happy with what she is, who she is. He's satisfied right there. Men, husbands, check this out. Real talk. In the past, I did, in my past marriages, did the disservice of not being me. I didn't allow Jason to always be Jason. For several different reasons. Majority of the time, it was because of ministry. And I allowed so many different stereotypes as far as ministry is concerned. I allow a lot of that stuff to minimize who Jason was. Next, I stopped being me because I didn't like to argue. And because I didn't like to argue, I became a yes man. Let me help y'all nice guys out. You guys that consider yourself the nice guy, and you know what the conversation is, nice guys always finish lies. Let me help y'all out. Women do want a nice guy. But women want a nice guy with a backbone. I had to learn this the extreme hard way. Women that we get in relationship with, they do want a nice guy. You know, with manners and know how to open up doors and all of this other stuff. But at the same time, when they say with a little bit of thug in them, all that means is they want a man with a backbone that would not only stand up for her when it's outside stuff coming at her, but sometimes you have to have the backbone to stand up to her as well. My grandfather used to say, stop pussyfooting around. We have to learn. We're talking about accountability. We talked about politics, politicians and stuff, and our what we need to do as a whole in America. But we're on men right now. You listen to me live on Life After the Collar. I am your host, J-Matt. We have to learn to hold ourselves accountable in this area, being a man, period. If you are a good man, you should be even a great father and a great husband. I'm not talking about no boyfriend. I ain't talking about that area of boyfriend stuff. I'm not talking about that because, you know, we still in the dating world, you know, you still trying to figure out what's what and all this other stuff. But when we become a husband, a fiance husband, once you make that commitment to her and say, hey, this is her. We got to step up our, as men, we got to step up our game on this thing as being a man, as being a husband, so that we can be better fathers, better husbands, better role models, better leaders in our community. We got to learn how to do this thing, because what we're doing now is falling so far behind. Our children are falling so far behind. All because we are out of place. You listen to me live here on Spreaker.com. This is Life After the Collar with J-Matt. We're talking about accountability. We're going to look at it in different areas and different ways to hold people accountable. I just got through talking about men. I'm going to go over here and talk about, we talked about earlier, about politicians and the political world and how it's so lopsided. We talked about that. Women, I'm coming for you next. It's all about being held accountable. All right? This is your boy, J-Man. Let's do this thing big. Holler at your boy.
The song I'd
do anything, you just give me a call.
This is a man's world. This is a man's world. But it wouldn't be nothing. Nothing without a woman or a girl. Take us over the road. Man made the train to carry the heavy load. Man made the electric light to take us out of the dark. Man made the boat by the water like Noah made the ark. This is a man. Baby boy, man makes them happy, 'cause man makes them toys. This is a man. She's alone in bitterness.
Everybody's gonna straighten out something sometime. I don't care how old you are or how young you are. I don't care if you're married, single, divorced, engaged, or shacking. You gotta straighten out something every now and then. But I want you to think about all the times that you've heard somebody say, let's straighten it out. Think about it. And I guarantee you that most of the time, it was a man who said it. Now, the reason why I say that is, well, let's face it, most of the time, it's a man who makes it crooked in the first place. We don't mean no harm. That's just the way we are. Sometimes we do have a tendency to sort of take you for granted, don't we? Always acting like we don't understand some things. But I believe a woman feels things deeper than a man. I don't care what nobody says. I believe a woman loves stronger than a man. Because you see, sometimes we just don't seem to understand. I know because, you see, I'm speaking from experience. Because I came home one day and my woman was just going all around the house not having very much to say. And I was kind of puzzled. I didn't know what to do. So I looked her straight in the eye and I said, sit yourself down, girl, and talk to me. Tell me what's on your mind. Don't you keep on telling me everything's okay? 'Cause if it wasn't, you wouldn't be crying. You've been tossing and turning in your sleep lately, baby. Sitting around pouting all day long.
Y'all, I promise you, that's what we need to do. We got to straighten this thing out. You listen to me live here on Spreaker.com, Life After the Collar radio show with your host, J-Man. Tonight, we're talking about accountability. And we're going to straighten this thing out tonight. We talked about, I let in what led me up to this conversation. I was sharing that I watched the French president, 45's Bromance, talk about, he came in and spoke to Congress today, and I talked about how I saw so many old white guys, you know, I don't blame them. They, like I said, they put their name, they did what they needed to do to get it into office. It's time for a change. We got that, that Congress and Senate, it need to look like America. It need to be more men and women in there. It need to be more young people in there. It need to be more minorities in there. Look, we got to do this thing for right. Accountability across the board. Then we just finished up a set holding men accountable. And I know I'm moving through it tonight. Usually when I get on a topic, I just let it roll. But I ain't want to beat a dead horse. Man, we got to step up this game. We sit there and blame women for all of this or blame the man for all of this. Come on, man. We got to step up our game for real. That's real talk. As husband and as men, we got to step up our game. But now, let's switch this thing over to the women. Hey there, women. My ladies. Here's how I'm going to hold the ladies accountable. Has nothing to do with motherhood. Has absolutely nothing to do with being able to cook, clean a house. I'm not even gonna go there with it. Here's what I would love. Here's the area that I want to hold women accountable. Stop being so, it's in your nature to be nurturing. It's in your nature. It's in your nature. And a lot of us guys, we probably would not be where we are if you all wasn't so nurturing to us and for us and do certain things for us. But ladies, stop being so nurturing. Here's what I mean by that. I was listening to some gentlemen. They was getting interviewed on, I guess, a college campus or something on television or something like that. But it was on Facebook. Somebody sent it to me in a message. And the men, and I talked about this last night, how, you know, us men, we'll kick ourselves to death. With that crab in the bat in a barrel thing, that's us men. Anyway, this guy was sitting here and he was saying how men mishandle our ladies, the women that we come across. And I agree with that. I wholeheartedly agree with it. And that's part of the conversation we just had a few minutes ago about having men learning to be real men. But ladies, let me help you all out. Here's where I'm going to hold you all accountable at. This thing that you all have, this heart that you all have, and this your feelings and your emotions. I know I'm gonna have a whole bunch of emails and phone calls and text messages. I know it. But I'm gonna say it anyway. Somebody texted me today that actually helped me out with this. And he said that he appreciate that I'm open and real, and I'm not scared to talk about it. Women, when the matters of the heart is at hand, stop freeing yourself up to be hurt by men. Here's how I'm going to hold you accountable. Here's how I want to hold you accountable. And I'm trying to talk in a gentle voice so that you can understand me and hear my heart. You all know, as we grow, that men aren't gonna automatically be heads over heels ready for commitment in the first, I'll say, month or whatever. We're not built like that. stop taking, and I say this all the time, and I got in a whole argument in another group, Facebook group that I was in. Stop taking yourself off the market because you done met this supposedly nice guy. Stop all of that. Make this guy, I was going to say another word, make this guy prove himself worthy of your heart, worthy of your emotions. The guy was saying on a video that was sent to me how we misuse and mishandle and how we cause so much hurt in women, and they in turn, when they get to the next relationship, they're bringing this hurt with them to the relationship, and it's a cycle thing. Yeah, we us guys, we do that. It is. Now it's nowadays both ways. But for the most part, it started from us, and we still lead the pack in this. Because I know my first real issue, what I call real love, adult love, I was the one that got hurt. But ladies, this is strictly, I'm a guy, and I'm speaking to you from a guy's point of view of what we do, how we do, and I'm trying to tell you all, save you all from being hurt all the time, because that hurt brings baggage to the next relationship. It really does. Whether you are dating whoever you're dating, whether you're dating Jason, whether you're dating J-Man, hold J-Man accountable. Don't just automatically say, here's my heart, because I can make you laugh, and I'm being real open and honest right in through here. I promise you I am. For the most part, I'm probably putting my own, put your own foot in your mouth. I'm probably doing, it is what it is. But I am open and honest right in through here. Even hold J-Mad accountable to earning your heart, to earning the right to be a part of your emotions. This is real talk. I want, ladies, if you don't, you can chop and dissect this thing and put it on internet or send it to your friends or however the video you want to do it. But here's what this is how I'm holding women accountable. Stop giving yourself away so easily. And what I mean by that is control how you give yourself away. I'm gonna share you something that I share with you that I share with my goddaughters. And you can talk to my goddaughters and they'll tell you this. I told them this, and even my niece. When it comes to your physical body, the most precious thing you have on this earth is your body. And to give it away to a guy is super special. It's super special. And you are the one that should be in control of when you give it away. Ladies, listen to me. You be in control when you give your body away and how often you give your body away. Here's why, and here's how. I'm gonna set up a scenario. This is grown folk conversation. As grown people, we have that itch that needs to be scratched. In other words, we want sex. We get horny. I don't care how super save you are. Y'all could play with me if y'all want to. Y'all could play like save people. Save people don't get horny. We get horny and we want some. It is what it is. Y'all let these folks sit up in a pulpit and tell y'all that no, you can pray this thing away. Some of this. let me be real with y'all. Ladies, we men and women, saved and unsaved, we get this thing that we have to have our itch scratched. I'm gonna be real honest with y'all. The woman that I respect the most is the one that controls her body and controls when she have sex, how she's have sex, and where she have sex. And then tell the Negro, because this is, I want this to be ethnic, multi-ethnic, cultural. Tell the dude, okay, you don't scratch me. You got to bounce. No, you can't sit up here and cuddle up under me. You got to go. I got to go to work in the morning. That's being in control of your body and in the control of this thing that gets y'all so messed up. Y'all heart and y'all mind and y'all emotions. I promise you. You want to know how to I'm gonna give you something that will let me help y'all out. Y'all, I'm talking on my radio broadcast, but if you listen to on me on Spreaker.com, Life After the Collar, I'm J-Mad, but I'm also on Facebook Live. I'm gonna move real close to the camera, and I'm gonna move real close to the mic. Let me help y'all out. Let me help y'all, ladies. Listen to me. You want to know how the question has been said so many times. How do you keep a man, or how do you keep a man from cheating? There is a way to keep a man from cheating. There really is. Make the guy feel and know that he is an option. You have not chosen yet. When you make a guy feel like he is an option and not the chosen one, that guy would do whatever it takes to win you over. He will raise his standard. He will change his lifestyle. He will do all of these other things because you haven't given him the crown. Y'all too busy. Y'all queens are too busy. Y'all too busy giving. Y'all got your own world. Y'all got, especially, let me, woo, good God. Y'all ones that's wearing, y'all got y'all crown. And I'm not talking about the ones that's walking around talking about I'm a queen. Let me help y'all out. Kings and queens. A king or a queen never has to announce that he is a king or a queen, or that she's a king or a queen. Whatever the case may be. Y'all know what I'm saying. The ones that's running around talking about I'm a king or I'm a queen, most of the time, they aren't. A queen never says that she's a queen. A king never says that he's a king. They have people that do that for them, and the people around them recognize them as such. Here's the thing. Stop giving guys the crown as the king of your territory. The sexiest thing in the world. Look, this is Life After the Collar. I got on beads tonight instead of a collar. Life After the Collar. The sexiest thing in the world to me is a woman that controls every aspect of herself. Her personal life as far as kids, children, her employment, her career. But most of all, her body. When she controls, hey, you know, come my way. I'm not waiting on you, dude, to come over. I'm not waiting for you to invite me over to your house so you get to kick me out your house. You need to go. It's time for you to go, ain't it? And you got to drive on the other side of town. No. You need to look. I'm feeling some kind of way today. You need to come over here and scratch this itch. I know this is not religious talk. I know y'all don't want to, y'all church folks don't want to talk about this. So if y'all too saved to talk about this and be real with me, because some of y'all saved folks are in the church horny as hell as ladies. Here's how I'm holding you all accountable. Be in control of your emotions. Be in control of your heart. It is absolutely nothing wrong with loving on a guy, showing a guy love. But let me tell you this. Do not give him the keys until he's proven yourself. I was gonna do this on another post or in another section. But I'm gonna say it right now, and I already kind of hinted at it. Y'all could tell this to y'all daughters. I'm finna cut a whole lot of this side chick stuff out. I'm gonna show y'all how to cut a lot of the side chicks off. Ladies, and I got it from because I forgot what this dude was talking about on I forgot that comedian, but he makes videos and they're kind of satire type of stuff. I forgot his name, but the skit went like this. So he picked up this young lady and they've getting ready to go hang out, and he was like, "Hey, babe, you know, look at it. We dressed alike. We got on blue jean outfits together. Let's take a selfie." And so the chick stops and she looks at him like, "You want to take a selfie?" "Yeah, let's take a selfie." So we take a selfie. Next thing you know, he was like, "Hey, babe, are you gonna cook that spaghetti like you said you was gonna fix? Can you fix me a plate?" She was like, "Yeah, you know, I'm sticking to it. I got you." And he was like, "Yeah, because you know, you don't make spaghetti like my mom. And my mom made it." She was like, "Whatever." And then he turns around and asks her to go pick up his shirts from the dry cleaner. And she did the most amazing thing to me. I need to find that video and show it, share it. What she does is she recognized. She said, "Wait a minute. That's domestic type of stuff." She's like, "Wait a minute. I'm your side chick. What you got me doing? This, that's for your main chick." And he was like, "Well, I broke up with my main chick, so you just got promoted to the main chick." And she was like, ho, wait a minute. I didn't sign up to be your main chick. I signed up to be your side chick. Y'all need to start making dudes y'all side dudes. Here's what I mean by that. I know it sounds shady, and I know it sounds unsaved or unreligious, but here's what I mean by that. And I already hinted at it earlier. Stop making everybody your main dude. Stop taking yourself off the market. Make somebody earn the spot to be your main dude. Hell, put in a bidding war on this thing. What you got? What you bringing to the table? What you bringing to the... But watch this. You better be bringing something to the table yourself. Oh, y'all, I know y'all. Look, it is what... I'm just being real. Whether I'm shooting myself in the foot, whether I'm punching myself in the eye, whether I'm crossing this guy code thing, maybe if I'm exposing the guy handbook or whatever the case may be, all I want to do is all of us to be held accountable for our own lives and stop blaming everybody else. Stop blaming that this dude over here treated you like this, that, and the other for 5 years. But this nigga, sorry. I am so sorry. Okay. Y'all been dating this dude for 5 years. And for 5 years, this dude has not treated you worth a dime. And in the 6th year, you're trying to figure out, oh, he done broke my heart. He done destroyed me emotionally. No, this dude, you allowed him. You gave him that space. Stop saying that he did all of this stuff to you. No, you allowed him to do it. Because it should only take one time for a person, anybody, men or women. Because I could flip this thing and put it, I'll show you my hand. I can show you. I can bring up a story. When I was 19 years old, fresh in the Navy, I'm over on the other side of the world. I done fell in love with this chick, dating her for 6 months. 6 whole months. Sleeping in her bed, eating her food, met her mom, hanging out with the family. Come to find out, this chick is married. Not halfway married, not unhappily married. It's just that he was gone out on a deployment. I was in the Navy, and she just wanted somebody to. I had stupid right across here. I ain't talking about, you know, I'm not talking about somebody that separated. I'm not talking about somebody that got divorce papers in the courts waiting on divorce or whatever the case may be. I'm not talking about that. She wasn't planning on leaving this dude. She was totally in love with this dude, in a sense. So this only guys are dog? No, women are too. That happened to me a couple of times. I had stupid on my forehead a few times. And it changed. So when women talk about they've been hurt and how it changed them, and how emotional they became and how hurt they became. And I used to describe myself this. I'm damaged goods. I'm like one of them damaged canned goods. That's how I used to describe myself. I don't anymore. Right now I'm in a happy place, but I had to learn all of this stuff. But neither here nor there. Women, do this. Whether it's dealing with, I think I'm a good guy. I think I'm a great guy. I think the right woman in my life will reach the stars with wherever she want to go, because I'm a pusher that hard. That's how I am. I'm a pusher that hard. But I come with baggage too. So whether you're dating me, or anyway, I'm not excluding myself. A lot of these guys, when they get on social media and all of these things, and they start talking about guys and how bad guys are, they put themselves over here, and that all the other guys are over here. No, I'm putting all of the guys, we're no good. Men, us men, will only do to you what you allow us to do. Ladies, be in control of your bodies, your hearts, your emotions, and your feelings. Them four things get y'all so jacked up. If I'm going to hold accountability, tonight here on Life After the Collar with J-Mad, we're talking about accountability. We already talked about political world. We already talked about men. We're talking about women. Those four things, women, because you all are not in control, you freely give those things away. You freely give your heart away. You give your feelings away. You give your emotions away. And you give your body away freely and not being in control. I'm not saying, watch this. I'm not saying that you can't give them away. I'm not saying that you're not supposed to do these things or you're not supposed to love freely. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is what women need to do is be in control of how you give those feelings away. It is what it is. When we learn, I don't know which sample that is. I see Will Sample. I don't know if that's Pastor or the son, but thank you so much for joining. Will Sample, Pastor Will Sample is the one that ordained me. I was talking the other day and I shared on Facebook. My license to preach, my ordination to preach, Will Sample, Pastor Will Sample in Jacksonville, Florida, New Life. was the pastor that ordained me to as a preacher. I got my ordination, me being called an elder by Will Sample. Thank you so much. I don't know which one that is, though, the son or the dad. Hey, sir, son. Hey, man, I've been, you know, congratulations. I know you've been married for a couple of years now, and you got your babies, man. Love you, man. It's good to see you, man. Good to see you. Always, man, it's my pleasure. I honor you, your dad, your family, your mom. I honor your brothers. I honor all of you all, man. You all don't know how much. It's been years since I've seen you all, but you all don't know how much I talk about you all wherever I go. What an influence you and your family had on my life. If when you see Pastor Sample, tell him I love him and that I honor him. Even it's been a couple of years now, but I honor and love you. Thank you so much. Bishop Simon Gordon is on tonight as well. You're listening to Life After the Collar with J-Mab. Look, we're just having a great conversation tonight. We're talking about accountability. Bishop Simon Gordon is in Chicago. If you ever get a chance, I need you all to go by. The church name slipped my mind. It's right there, and I was just, because I go every Sunday. I go by Bishop. I offer the Tridstone in Chicago. Tridstone in Chicago. Wonderful bishop, wonderful guy. He has books out. He has music CDs out. Matter of fact, we was talking about political office. This is one of the guys. Bishop Gordon is one of the guys that's actually putting his mouth. His actions where his mouth is. We were talking about the political world. He was just running for office there in Chicago. But if y'all get a chance to go by Tridstone there in Chicago, you will be blessed. I promise you, you will be blessed. I'm talking about this dude. When he preaches, you better have your thinking. You better come with the right frame of mind, because you're going to learn something there. All right? We're going to get back into this music thing. We're going to take a musical break here and just get into some good music. Y'all know how I do. I love music. There's no telling which way I'm going to go with this thing. There was actually no idea. Sometimes I may do country. Sometimes I may do old schools. Other times I may do, you know, there's really, really, really no telling which way I'm going to go. This right here, I want to dedicate this to the we just got through talking about holding women accountable. I'm going to dedicate this one to the women. It's called Love Yourself. I know it's kind of shady the way he's throwing off, but my mindset is this. I had to learn this myself. I had to learn to love myself. I know he's kind of throwing shade in this song, but that phrase there, love yourself, is what it's all about. Learn how to love yourself. It's all good. You listen to J-Mad on Life After Collar on Spreaker.com. Holler at your boy. It's all good. It's all gravy. Holler at me.
For all the times that you rain on my parade, and all the clubs you get in using my name, you think you broke my heart, oh girl, for goodness sake. You think I'm crying on my own, well I ain't. And I didn't wanna write a song, 'cause I didn't want anyone thinking I still care or don't. But you still hit my phone up, and baby I'll be moving on. And I think it should be something I don't wanna hold back. Maybe you should know that my mama don't like you, and she likes everyone. And I never like to admit that I was wrong. And I've been so caught up in my job, didn't see what's going on. But now I know I'm better sleeping on my own. 'Cause if you like the way you look that much, oh baby, you should go and love yourself. And if you think that I'm still holding on to something, you should go and love yourself. When you told me that you hated my friends, the only problem was with you and not them. And every time you told me my opinion was wrong,
try to make me forget where I came from. And I didn't want to write a song, 'cause I didn't want anyone thinking I still care or don't. But you still hit my phone up, and baby, I'll be moving on. And I think it should be something I don't want to hold back. Maybe you should know that my mama don't like you, and she likes everyone. And I never like to admit that I was wrong. And I've been so caught up in my job, didn't see what's going on. But now I know I'm better sleeping on my own. 'Cause if you like the way you look that much, oh baby, you should go and love yourself. And if you think that I'm still holding on to something, you should go and love yourself. For all the times that you made me feel small, I fell in love, now I feel nothing at all. I never felt so low when I was vulnerable. Was I a fool to let you break down my walls? 'Cause if you like the way you look that much, oh baby, you should go and love yourself. And if you think that I'm still holding on to something, you should go and love yourself. 'Cause if you like the way you look that much, oh baby, you should go and love yourself. And if you think that I'm still holding on to something, you should go and love yourself.
Oh, Yeah, real talk, Will J Mad, he gotcha. Right here doing God's work, bringing life after the collar. Hey, radio show, and he's doing it big. You just can't ignore J Mad, bringing you the word. Just holler at your boy. Hey, life after the collar with J Mad.
Listen to J Mad weekdays on Spreaker.com.
I'm supposed to heal ya, but I ain't done much healing. Hello, can you hear me? I'm in California dreaming about who we used to be when we were younger and free. I've forgotten how it felt before the world fell at our feet. There's such a difference between us and a million miles. So hail from the other side. I must have called a thousand times to tell you.
You're listening to Life After the Collar with J-Map. We've actually had a really, really great conversation tonight. We talked about accountability. We talked about the political world and how divisive that is, but it's really not. I was saying how we was talking about the, I was watching the French president talk to Congress, and when he was walking in, it was easily, I said 90, but I would say 95% white old men in there. I don't blame them for being in where they are, because they did what they needed to do in order to get into office. We got to do what we need to do. So in the political world, I hold all of us accountable. I was saying that I'm not going to hold myself. I'm going to stop talking that I'm going to run for office, or I'm going to support this candidate verbally. Actually get out there and do the work to push him. Bishop Simon Gordon was on just a few minutes ago up in Chicago. He put his money where his mouth is. He ran for an office. We talked about men and how we, as men, we need to be better men, better fathers, better husbands. I put myself in that group. I didn't exclude myself. I know a lot of these videos that y'all see with these guys sitting here, ladies giving y'all advice about men, and they put themselves over here and they talk about all the men, and they, when they talking about they, what they do, and they're not saying we, you got a problem. So us men, we got to step up our game. We then talked about women, ladies, and what you all need to do. And I was very specific. Not Pacific, like Pacifico, specific on what my accountability to you all are. Be in control of y'all bodies, y'all emotions, y'all feelings. Okay? And your hearts. Now, where are we now? Who can I jump on now? As far as holding people accountable. Getting ready to get real ugly. I know I will probably lose a lot of friends. Y'all know me. Most of y'all, well, some of y'all may not know me. Life after the collar means I used to wear a collar, which means I am an ordained minister. I can marry you and bury you. That's all ordination is really. I could do. Ordination is for three reasons. Three reasons only. The only reason you get ordained is for three reasons. Well, four reasons. I can marry you. Well, three reasons. I can marry you. I can bury you. And I can pastor you. Those are only three reasons I need ordination. If you're chasing ordination papers. Oh, I done already jumped in the water and I didn't even know I was there. I didn't even see the bus coming and it was already on top of me. Ordination is for three reasons and three reasons only. So that I can be your pastor, so that I can marry you, and so that I can bury you. Those are the only three reasons you really need ordination papers for. You have to be ordained to marry somebody, to bury somebody, or to pastor somebody. Y'all looking at me crazy. So the other day, yes, I think probably yesterday. So I'm decorating my house and all of this other stuff. And so one of my rooms, two of the rooms, I'm really taking some really good time in trying to figure out how I'm gonna do this thing. So one room I turned into a living room. The other room is basically my bedroom that I'm gonna do. And so I don't know why I said all of that, but I came across a plaque, and this plaque was my, my certificate of recognition as a senior pastor in the Full Gospel Baptist Church Fellowship. The bottom two is my license to preach back in 1989. And my ordination as an elder in 03. I think it was, 03. Listen to what I just said. Listen to what I just said. I became a preacher, a licensed preacher in 1989. I became an ordained preacher in 03. That's over 10 years later. Not because they didn't want me to. Not because my gift did not. Because here's the thing. I'll give you the story. May he rest right now in peace right now. Pastor Jake Russell down in Noonan, Georgia. He wanted me to get my ordination. All the other preachers were always questioning him, when we're going to get our ordination? When we're going to get our ordination? And he asked me one day in the office, because usually when it came to preaching or being on Sunday, I was the only one that was showed up on time. I was the only one in Sunday school. I was the only one that was helping him during that time period. And he asked me one day, he said, why don't you ever ask me to be ordained? I said, because to be ordained, it means to you got to know certain things. You got to know how to operate. I said, first of all, I can do what I need, what I'm called to do without ordination papers. I don't need ordination papers to do what God called me to do. I need ordination papers to do what y'all want me to do. Y'all want me to pastor you? Y'all, I'm getting ready. I did not want to go here tonight. Y'all want me to pastor y'all? Y'all want me to marry you? Y'all want me to bury you? That's the only reason I need ordination papers for. So I'm getting ready to jump on accountability of ministers and church folks. And I'm going to try to make this as basic as I possibly can. A lot of people need to check their, I'm not judging. I'm just saying you need to check. I'm not saying it's you don't have one. I'm not saying that it's in a default. I'm not saying your relationship with God is wrong. All I'm saying, I'm being as polite as I possibly can. Some folks, a lot of folks, a lot of us, and I'm using us because I'm going to throw myself in the same conversation. I'm going to throw myself, my own personal life, in the same boat. A lot of us need to check. Jackie, good to see you. Susan, good to see you. Who else? Wendell, Pastor. Pastor Sam's good to see you. Michelle, you're back on. Deanna, you're back on. Sheila, you're back on. Frida, you're back on. Let me help y'all out. A lot of us need to check our relationship with God. Here's why. The word tells us this. We will know the tree by the fruit it bears. Not judge the tree. Not convince the tree that you're something that you're not. We will simply know the tree by the fruit it bears. That's why people can talk about you. And you not worry. Because you know what fruit is on your tree. I don't worry about people talking about me. I don't worry about people going after me. I just don't. I don't have time to do that. Because I know me. I know who I am. Call me whatever you want to call me. Why? Because they call Jesus whatever they wanted to call him. How are you going to reign with me if you don't even know how to suffer with me? I'm just saying. I'm not, you know. So here's what I need for us. So we talked about women. I held women accountable, men accountable. Us accountable as in the political world. Let me talk about us Christians, us saved folks. Let me quickly talk about us saved folks. Here's how I'm going to hold us saved folks. I was going to say church folk, but I want to include church folks and saved folks. There is a difference. FYI. Be mindful of who you consider your leader. Overseer, Pastor Coleman, good to see you. Thank you so much for chiming in, sir. I got to get you here, sir, and we can do this radio show together. We got to do this radio show together. We got to be mindful on who we decide to follow and understand the reason we are following who we are following. It is important to your soul. Forget everything else. When it comes to your spiritual life, it is important to choose wisely on who you follow. Here's why. A lot of times what happens is this. We follow people because it's popular, because they're popular. We follow people because they can make us shout. We follow people because they make us feel a certain way. But if you're not following a person that can get you delivered and challenge your mindset and your spiritual walk, something is wrong. If you go to church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday and you never offended by the word of God, I know y'all just mess y'all up. I know I just mess y'all up with that. The word of God should offend you. The word of God should offend you in different aspects because we are unclean people. We want what we want, how we want it. The word of God should come against that and challenge you to be better, to do better, and show you that you're not as clean as you think you are. If you attend a ministry that makes you feel like your life is all together, something is wrong. I just wanted that to sink in a little bit. Something is wrong. You cannot attend any church, be under any leadership that is comfortable with you being you. I go to Pastor Coleman's church in Lithonia, Georgia, Ellenwood, Georgia, and in that area there. Church on the move. By the way, if y'all need to, if you're in an ATL and you're looking for a good spot to get to be challenged, and you got gifts that you want to sow in, and you haven't had your chance, not stealing folks, people, but you, God is telling you there's more. I got a spot for you. Holler at me, inbox me, jbmadison72@gmail.com, or hit me up on Facebook. But if you're going to church and you're never being challenged and they're comfortable with you coming to church the way you come and they're comfortable with you leaving the way you leave, same way you came in, as long as you give your tithe, you're doing yourself, your own self, an injustice. Get to a place. I'm going to say it again. I'm going to say it real slow. Get to a place where you are around people. You are around leadership that's challenging you to be better, to grow more, to change the way you think, to stop being selfish. Find a spot. Find leadership. And I know you know, this new age millennium thing, we go to church online and all of this other stuff. And we talked yesterday, this social media stuff. Everybody on social media ain't for your good. All these folks running around on social media calling themselves pastors and bishops and apostles and prophets and evangelists and all of this other stuff, and they ain't got no credentials behind it. I know what we say, or God give that gift, and bring it back. Let me tell y'all this. God, everybody that God used in biblical days, they were properly trained, educated, and vetted. They were properly trained, educated, and vetted. They did not just get out there and just start doing stuff. They submitted themselves, first of all, to leadership. I was talking a few minutes ago. I purposely, on my own, they wanted me to be an ordained minister way before I became ordained. But it wasn't about that. It was well over 10 years before I became an elder in the church. I need to be ordained. It's been 2 years. You don't know nothing yet. You calling yourself a bishop and you 20 years old. How do you tell somebody to stay with their husband or their wife after 20 years of marriage? Now they clowning. How do you don't know nothing. Oh God, let me. This is Life After the Collar with your boy J Mad. Be careful who you choosing to be your leader. When it comes to your soul, outside of loving yourself, your soul is so important. Choose wisely. Choose you this day who you will serve. It's all good. It's all gravy. Get ready to get out of here for the night. This is your boy, J Mad. We almost put in 2 hours of this thing. I want to listen to some of this. This is my boy. See, I actually opened up the show with this tonight. I'm going to close it out with this one right here. You're listening to Live, Life After the Collar with J Mad. It's all good. It's all gravy. I'll let you, boy.
can't mess with her mind. She feels the same, she'll let you know. Just prepare yourself and be ready to go. And I hope this message stays in your mind, cause you almost lost a girl who was right on time. Here's one more thing that you got to know. Just cool it down and stay in control.
Cool it down.
Have had a great show tonight here on Life After the Collar with J-Mad. Want you all to join me every week, weekday on Life After the Collar. It has been a great honor and a great privilege to be allowed into your space for these couple of hours. I do appreciate it. I do not take it for granted. We have a lot of things working on. We're on like 6 or 7 different social media sites. We have the app that's coming out the beginning of the month. And today I had a conversation with a guy that we may be able to do some things. I told you all one of my dreams is to have my television program as well. And that looks like it's going to be a really, really, really great possibility. I'm going to work on another show probably. Maybe behind the scenes type of stuff, but I already pitched my idea of what I want. My girl Peaches just came on. That's my baby girl there. I haven't seen her in a while. She's down there in Florida. I think she's still down in Florida. Peaches, hey baby girl on Facebook. One of my little baby girls, I call her my daughter. Still, one of my baby girls. I still love her to life. But we got a lot of different things that's happening here on Life After the Collar. I need y'all to stick with me. I want you all to share. I want you all to share. And then I want you all to share again. We have Instagram. Hashtag Life After the Collar. We have our own group on Facebook. I know the old folks, we use Facebook. Young folks, y'all use Instagram. So I try to balance that thing out. My show goes off on Twitter. My show goes off on Facebook. Spotify's picked us up. And all these other things. YouTube, it goes out live on YouTube. Even Google has a thing platform that they submit my stuff out as well. So I need you all to just hook up with me, ride with me. It's been good. It's been great. But tonight we had a great conversation. Every day, every weekday, we're on live. On the weekends, what I usually do is just play some music and just have a good time. Thank you all so much for just hanging out with me tonight. I appreciate you all. God, thank you so much for your love, your grace, your mercy. We ask you, God, to cover us and keep us safe. Let no harm or danger come to us tonight as we rest. This is our prayer tonight. God, we love you and we praise you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You all have a good night. Facebook, thanks for rolling with me. So, Spreaker.com, Life After the Collar, thank you all so much for rolling with me as well. Thank you all. Be good. Be good. Monique, this is the end of it. Catch the replay. Holler at your folks. You all have a good night. Bye-bye. Y'all be good.
See, I can kind of recall a little ways back. Small trying to ball, always been black. And my hair, I tried it all. I even went flat. Had a gumby curly top and all that crap now. Just trying to be appreciated. Nappy-headed brothers never had no ladies. Then I hit the barbershop real quick. Had them give me little twists and it drove them crazy. I couldn't get no job. This corporate wouldn't hire no dreadlocks. Ooh, then I thought about my dogs on the block. Kinda understand why they chose to steal and rob. Was it the hair that got me this far? All these girls, these cribs, these cars. I hate to say it, but it seems so flawed. Cause success didn't come till I cut it all off.
Little girl with the pressing curl. Age 8, I got a Jerry curl. 13 and I got a relaxer. I was a source of so much laughter. At 15, when it all broke off. 18.